Good morning, House of Purpose. Thank you for being here. We are going to get started. And today is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. So I'm going to open us up with some prayer. Fellas,
ladies and gentlemen,
yes. we're gonna do some prayer here. Father, in Jesus' name, we do invite you into the service. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. You are welcome in our lives. We are so thankful for you. We're thankful for the Word of God. We thank you, Lord, that you keep us in line. We thank you for your forgiveness and for your love. And we just offer you this praise and worship so we can celebrate and adore you. And it's in Jesus' holy, mighty name that I ask and pray. Amen. This is called Thy Word. And it's about, Thy Word is a lamp unto my feet. How He guides us. Amen. Psalm 105.
Unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and I think I've lost my
belongs to the Lord. We sing, Lord.
set a standard, the power of his blood. The battle belongs to the Lord, and we sing. My friend, your redemption is near. The battle belongs to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. We sing. My friend, your redemption is near. The battle belongs to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And Father, we thank you that you have prepared our hearts to encounter you, to receive the word that is alive and active and does not return void. And these are seeds planted in our heart and minds that you bring to fruition. And it's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
I want to talk to you a little bit about trusting God and God alone. It ties in with the battle belongs to the Lord also. So how many of you this week have been reading in our daily bread? You know, we always give that out. I know Pastor David and I are doing it, and some of you are also. And you might remember that this week there was a story in there from 1 Samuel 4. That was the one that was talking about Ichabod, talking about no glory. And so let me just give you a little bit of background on this story that is in 1 Samuel 4. So we've got the Israelites are fighting the Philistines. And the Philistines were a people group that was living in the area where they were in the land of Israel. And they were arrayed in battle in front of them. And they had just lost a really big battle. They lost about 4,000 people. And so they were kind of like, what's going on here? This shouldn't be happening to us. And so they said in 1 Samuel 4:3, which is on the screen here for you, it says, "And when the people had come into the camp, the elders of Israel said, 'Why has the Lord defeated us today before the Philistines? Let us bring the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord from Shiloh to us, that when it comes among us, it may save us from the hand of our enemies.'" So notice that they didn't say that God would save them. They said it would save us. They were focusing on the Ark of the covenant instead of the God of the covenant. You know, so that's the first thing that they did wrong. And I wanted to show you a picture. I've got a picture here of the Ark of the Covenant. This is just an artist's rendition of this, but this was something that God had told them to create. He had given them instructions, and he had had them put certain items in there that were meant to be a remembrance of him and his miracles that he had done. So inside you would have found a golden pot of manna. There was also an almond branch, or it was a staff, actually, that Aaron had when it was no longer connected to the tree and it budded. That was one of them. And then the other one was the Ten Commandments would have been in there. You know, and so all of this was meant to be a reminder of what God had done. But God never meant it to be like a substitute for God. You know, and he told them that he would meet with them there. That was the mercy seat is in between the two cherubim there. And he said, my presence would be there. But over time, the Israelites had kind of gotten to where they were starting to focus more on just the physical box instead of on God. You know, and they were also adopting some practices from their from the Philistines and the other people around them, because those people worshipped idols. So I think they were starting to get kind of where they were just turned their own, you know, kind of relics into idols there. So they went into battle with the ark, you know, and the Eli, who was the high priest at the time, he was very worried about the ark, and I guess rightly so, because they went into battle thinking that this ark was going to save them. And it was an even a way worse battle. They lost 30,000 people, and the ark was captured. You know, so that turned out to be just a horrible tragedy for them. Eli, the priest, it says that when he discovered and found out that the ark had been captured, it said he fell off his chair and he broke his neck because he was old and heavy. You know, so and everybody was very upset. His two sons had been killed as well. Hophni and Phinehas. And Phinehas's wife was pregnant, and so she was getting soon to deliver, so she went into labor because of all of the stress of this. And they told her, hey, you're having a baby boy. You should be happy, at least, you know, even though all this other stuff has happened. But she was inconsolable. She was like, no, the glory is gone out of Israel because the ark had been captured, and she died. You know, and the thing that I just thought was so interesting about this is I think it's really easy to start focusing on sometimes like rituals or, you know, like what you normally do, like in your heart is not in it. You know, have you ever done that where maybe even in worship or something, we're supposed to be focusing on the Lord and singing to the Lord, but your mind's 1,000 miles away. You know, you're thinking about what am I having for lunch, you know, or you might be thinking about what do I have to do this week or something that's gone wrong. You know, maybe even a disagreement you're having with somebody, you're thinking about it. You know, I think it's just really easy to not have your heart in it. And those things are kind of like this ark was to them. They're not bad. They're things that God even created for us. But our heart has to be in it. You know, and as a pastor, I just feel like really this, you can fall into this very easily because this is what we do. You know, you're preparing messages for people. You know, it can turn out that you're devotional time with the Lord is more about I got to find a message, you know, than actually having time with the Lord. You know, so I think it's really something that we have to focus on and really just turn our heart. And so I have Samuel, the priest Samuel. He had really good advice for the people. So in chapter 7, verse 3, he said to all the people, if you want to return to the Lord with all your hearts, get rid of your foreign gods and your images of Ashtoreth, turn your hearts to the Lord and obey him alone, then he will rescue you from the Philistines. You know, so basically it's just that, just get rid of all the stuff that's a substitute for God, that's, you know, getting in the way of your relationship with God, and just turn your heart towards him. And then he will defeat the Philistines, and the battle will belong to the Lord. You'll know that it was God who did it. So I just wanted to encourage you with that today, and we're going to receive our offerings and our prayer requests in just a minute. But let's say our giving declaration about why we give here. So we say that we give so others may live by faith in Jesus Christ. And so when you give, that you're a part of that. You're a part of helping this neighborhood come to know the Lord, you know, and helping us to be out, you know, in here and also out there proclaiming that message. And we have a few different ways that you can give. You know, if you want to do text to give, we have that. It's up on the screen. You can go to our website and give. You know, for those of you on YouTube, we've got the mail-in address on the screen there. But we're going to receive the offerings as well here in the service and your prayer requests. So I'm going to pray over that, and then they're going to come receive that. Well, dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for everything that you do for us. We thank you that this battle does belong to you. And Lord, we just choose to turn our hearts to you, Lord, to really focus on you and to, you know, just everything that we do, you know, that whatsoever we do, whether we eat or drink, like it says in Corinthians, may we do it for your glory, Lord. And I just thank you for that. I pray, Lord, that you'd use these offerings to draw other people into your family. And I pray that you'd also bless everyone who's giving, Lord, that you'd provide for them, that they would really find that you are the one who is their provider. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Famous Pizza down the street. If you'd like to have some good pizza, you can go down to Famous Pizza. It's two blocks away. It's on Ivanhoe Street. So really good Philly cheesesteak dinner there. But a great crew that we had here and a lot of people from the community. As I mentioned, I tend to study the community. I take the long way here sometimes just so I can watch and observe what people are doing. There's our fellowship hall, by the way. And there's the District 2 police commander. And Anna Gabrielle Sawyer. Oh, she yeah. changed her name. She got married. She used to be Anna Gabrielle Hercha, but she's married now. And so she's a young married person. So that is Jacob. He's from our neighborhood, too. So that was a good time in the Lord. Some good pictures. There's Elaine. Great picture of Elaine right over there. So good time. Good time in the Lord. Are you ready for the Word of God, though, today? We're going to break bread today. We're going to talk together about the Word of God. You know, the Word of God tells us, you know, hey, talk about the Word when you walk along the roadside and by the wayside and this side and that side and the other side and when you're together and when you're apart, all that sort of thing. That's my paraphrasing of Deuteronomy, by the way. But I want to share with you about, you know, resting secure in God, resting secure in God. That's a great picture up on the screen, by the way. I like that. Sometimes we think we got to take control, guys, huh? We got to think we got to pick up the sword. We like those songs that we sing about Almighty and powerful God and everything, but yet we want to pick up the sword, don't we? And we want to do our thing, you know, and we want to sometimes help God. But I want to talk about resting in God today and being secure in that. And we're in Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 1 through 5, and verse 12 today. And it starts out and it says, "Let Reuben live and not die, nor his people be few. And this he said about Judah, hear, hear the Lord, the cry of Judah, bring him to his people. Bring him to his people. With his own hands he defends his cause." With his own hands God defends his cause. "Oh, be his help. Oh, be his help against his foes." Moses was a blessing to the Israelites before his death. He gave a traditional blessing of a father before his death. As an example, when you read Genesis 49, Jacob either blesses his son or he prophetically speaks over his son. Guys, if you have kids, speak blessing over your kids. Speak blessing over your family. Amen? It's easy to discourage them. The Word of God says, do not frustrate your child. Speak over your child. Amen? So Moses also addresses the 12 tribes of Israel as if they were his sons as well. And I believe he's speaking from the oracles of God. He sought God early in the morning. Amen. He went up the mountain. So his blessing is the form of an intercessory prayer. When he says what we just read in Matthew 33, "Let Reuben live and not die, nor his people be few." And he said this about Judah, "Hear, O Lord, the cry of Israel. Bring him to his people with his own hands. He defends his cause." He takes up his own cause. That's what he's saying. "Oh, be his help against his foes." Are you with me? Judah takes up his own cause, but God, you got to help him. You got to help him. And sometimes we want to make things happen, don't we, folks? Sometimes we want to make it happen all by ourselves. We say, "Hey, God, you're taking too long." As if God could take too long or too little time or whatever it is. Point number one, when we pray directly and personally to God, we give him our concerns, don't we? We rest secure in him when we pray, don't we? That's what we're supposed to do. But sometimes we pray and then we reconsider, well, maybe I should handle this because it's taking too long. And that's a dangerous place to be. We need to rest secure in God. And then the blessing of Moses in Deuteronomy 33, 1 through 2. This is the blessing with which Moses, the man of God, blessed the sons of Israel before his death. This is the blessing. The Lord came from Sinai and dawned on them from Seir. He shone from the Mount of Paran. He came from among the 10,000 holy ones. At his right hand was a flaming fire. It is his law for them. It was his right hand was a flaming fire and a law for them. His strength was everything. His word was everything, folks. His word, his will be done on earth as in heaven. Don't we pray that from time to time? His will. When we dwell in God's word, it is a light and it makes our path forward clear. Without being in the word, we don't have a clear path forward, do we? We need God to speak to us. We need him to talk to us. When we moved in this building, we needed to seek his ways about what we should do that should be different. We could get nostalgic about what happened on 8720 East Colfax. Or we can move forward in what he has for us in the future. Amen? It's good to remember where you came from, but it's not a good place to dwell. You're supposed to move forward into the promises of God. Amen? Psalm 119, 105 says, your word is a lamp unto my feet, a light into my path. Didn't we just sing that? The NIV Cultural Background Study Bible in the Old Testament times, lamps, see, they were made out of clay, and they were pierced at one end with a wick. And they were primarily used, and they were used for indoors. They weren't meant for traveling inside, or outside, rather. They were for inside, because they were worried about breaking the lamp. Amen? We are like a lamp. We are men made of clay, women made of clay. Out from dust to dust we go, from ashes to ashes. We talk about that. We're made out of the earth. God formed man out of the earth. So we're like these clay lamps. Sometimes we keep the lamp inside too long rather than take it outside to shine the light to the rest of the world. That's why Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Amen? It was a reference to the lamp. We want to keep our situation under control. We want to shine our light in our home, but we're a little bit intimidated by going out beyond the boundaries and shining a light to the world sometimes. Or maybe there's no oil in the lamp. And that can become a problem too, because Jesus is coming back, folks. And we need to have oil in our lamp. Our lamp needs to be lit all the time. We need to be on fire for God, don't we? Not even the moon can illuminate the way a child of God with an oil in his lamp or her lamp can illuminate the world. With Jesus living big inside of us, we don't have to worry about oil spilling out. We would want it to spill out, wouldn't we? They were concerned that the oil would spill out if they took the lamp outside. That was the chief concern. Not only that it was breakable, but it might spill out. But folks, listen to me. We've got to trust in the Lord. And we've got to take the light to the world. If we don't, then we become simply a social club. Amen? We might as well just have coffee together and call it good at the end of the day. Amen. Have a few donuts. The donuts are great. I love those ones that are, what are they called? They're sourdough donuts? Sour cream. Okay, not sourdough. Sour cream. Get it straight, Pastor. Point number three is this. God's word is the light of our life. And we need to seek light long before we venture out of our homes. But we got to venture out of our homes with the light. So we got to seek the light while we're in our homes and go forth in the light to the world. Matthew 33:3. Indeed, he loves his people. All your holy ones are in your hand. They follow your steps. They accept. They receive your direction. They receive your direction. They know which way to go, which way to flow. Amen? How to move in the Holy Spirit. Pastor Kym and I and Doug, one of the guitar players that came in after we got done with the open house, we took a walk down to a guy at the coffee shop. He sells belt buckles and all kinds of stuff. He's just one block around the corner here. He wants to have our worship band over there and do a concert in his parking lot. Isn't that wonderful? We get a chance to shine a light over there, and we can go over there as a congregation. Now, the man is a little bit rough around the edges, and we get nervous with people rough around the edges. I mean, the man can drop a few F-bombs when he chooses to. But what else would you expect? If you're going to go out into the world and face the world, there's going to be some rough edges. But as you begin to shine God's light into those areas of people, I remember I thought about myself. Folks, when I became a Christian, when I received Christ, I didn't immediately stop cussing. Amen? It took a while, right? But the light had to come in and show me those rough edges in my life. And we've got an opportunity with this place that we're in to bring light into the rough edges. We got some beautiful people around here. I am excited about them. There's a lady that is a gold medalist fencer. She's right over in this building over here. And I call her the animal sanctuary lady because she has parrots in there. She has little baby squirrels she takes in. She has them in a little pouch on her belt, and they kind of cuddle up in there. And you know, you just got to go out, and you got to take the light out there, and you got to enjoy the people that God wants to save. Amen? And God has brought us here for such a time as this. The Orthodox Study Bible says the Son of God was the lawgiver who gave Moses his words, and Moses, in turn, he gave them to Israel. So we can receive the word, but we need to also give it out. Amen? We got to give it out in the way that we live. We got to give it out in the way that we shine our light. We got to be strategic in what we do. We got to let it be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Amen? The Believer's Bible Commentary says this is his final official act that Moses, the man of God, pronounced blessing on the tribes of Israel. The blessing is conditional on the trust of God's word. You say, well, my life isn't so blessed. I want to ask you, are you trusting in God? Are you trusting in his word? Then blessing will follow your life. It will become a way of life, folks. It will become an answer to prayer instead of just a prayer when I'm in desperation. I will share this with you often, folks. People live their lives sometimes as Christian as if Jesus was walking behind them instead of in front of them. When did you become Lord and he's not? When did you start walking ahead of God and taking matters into your own hands? He needs to be in front of you. He needs to lead you. He needs to be Lord of your life. We need to trust God, don't we? At his word. And find it as a true source of security. Because within his word are some promises that you need to grab a hold of with both hands, 2 feet, and whatever it takes, folks. You got to make his promises. You got to make his word your own. Amen? That you would live by it and live in it and experience it. I can speak God's word today. But until you live it, it does not become truth in your life. So we need to trust God that his promises are yes and amen. Deuteronomy 33:4, Moses commanded us with his law as a possession for the assembly of Jacob. It was a blessing for them to live in, folks, and it is a blessing for us to live in it. Deuteronomy 28:2, all these blessings will come upon you. They will overtake you. If, here's the condition, if you pay attention to his voice, his word, by making it a way of life. It's not something I hear, it's something I live by. When we do our miracle lunch, we go into suburban churches, and I want to tell you why. And we share the miracles, the things that have happened in people's lives, the testimonies. And somebody in here is going to become the next testimony of God because they will trust in his promises. They will make it a way of life. But when we go into the suburban churches, there are a lot of people, they may have heard the word of God and they may have sat in a church. But they've never lived it. They've never experienced it. They never walked out in it. So when we bring a miracle lunch into a suburban church, what we want to do is inspire them and edify that congregation to living out the principles of God. It isn't, folks, just a fundraiser. It is a life changer. Amen? It is a life changer. They are the next miracles about to happen, just as someone in here is going to experience a miracle today. You can be secure in God, folks, because God will do battle for you. He will do battle for you when you stand on his word by making it your way of life. Deuteronomy 33:5, the Lord was king in Jeshurun, Israel, when all the heads of the people were gathered, the tribes of Israel together. He was Lord. They became of one accord. He was Lord. Now, is he Lord over all the universe? Yes. But that day, in that city, before the eyes of those people, he was Lord. That's why it describes just that single city. Can you imagine the blessing that fell upon that place that day? What if the people of God made him Lord and trusted in him completely in the house of God today? In a powerful way. I know that the Holy Spirit would fall upon this place. Healings would take place. Blessings would take place. Gifts of the Spirit would move. People would start speaking with the oracles of God to each other. They would start. Oh, you know what? In Moses' time, there was people started speaking prophetically. And I said, man, there's people walking out through the camp speaking prophetically. Talking. And speaking prophetically, and Moses was basically, well, what of it? They're actually living. Isn't that what we want to do? And then Acts came, and the Holy Spirit was poured out, and people began to do what? They began to prophesy, speak with unknown tongues, and in everyone else's language. God wants to do miracles in the house of God when people live for God, amen? When they make him Lord, when they say, you know what, I will trust in the Lord, I will rest in the Lord, he is my security. In 2 Chronicles 20:15, he said, listen carefully, you people of Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem, and you, King Jehoshaphat, listen, the Lord says this to you, don't be afraid. He says, don't be dismayed. Don't be double-minded, in other words. at this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, it is God's. It is God's. Isn't it good to know that God is on your side? Isn't it good to rest in that fact? One of the things that I can feel good about, although sometimes I enter into situations I shouldn't, when Nancy talks to me and she starts carrying a conversation with me, and this is a tip for you guys, she isn't necessarily asking me to solve the problem. She's processing the situation. And if you let her continue to speak, she will figure it out for herself, as if God is helping her. Amen? But guys, if we jump in and try to fix it, ladies are laughing all over this room. If you say, you know what, let her just talk and listen for a while. You'll be amazed at the miracle that will happen, because she will all of a sudden come around to solving the problem herself. And you can just sit there and go, well, hallelujah, I didn't have to do anything. Amen? It's the truth, gentlemen. Keep practicing and living in it, and you will live a blessed life. Amen? Today, the Lord is saying the same thing in our situation. Or to someone you desire to help. Hope in Him. Hope in Him, because why? He loves you. Amen? He loves you unconditionally. You don't have to live in fear. So you don't have to live in discouragement. When you feel attacked by things bigger than yourself, how are you going to fix it anyway? You must remember the battle is not yours, it is the Lord's. Deuteronomy 20, verse 4 says this, for the Lord God is your help. He goes with you, see, to fight for you against your enemies, to save you. And I can't tell you how many times He's saved me from myself. Amen? Some of the biggest battles are happening inside here. Amen? And so many times He has saved me from myself. You think, well, I can remember when I got saved. It was in 1982. Okay? I remember when it happened. But the truth of the matter is, God has been saving me from myself continually, day by day, from that time since. I'm continually being saved, folks, from a battle that is going on inside. Paul said, there's a war going on inside my members. One wants to do the right thing, the other one does not. It's called the sin nature, folks. And we want to do things our own way. We want to fix it ourselves instead of relying on God. And when we rely on God, a healing starts to take place in our hearts. Amen. Deuteronomy 1:30 says, the Lord your God who goes before you will Himself fight for you as He did for you in Egypt before your eyes. What is He saying there? He's saying, do you remember how He saved you from the bondage that you were in Egypt? Remember when you were eating leeks and onions? I remember when I was cooking on a hot plate in an infested room with cockroaches. I remember when I was in Egypt, folks. I remember when I ate macaroni and cheese until I thought my eyeballs were going to pop. And it wasn't even Kraft macaroni and cheese. It was generic macaroni and cheese. Have you ever been in a place like that? This place was a 6-level building that was like Colfax, all in one building. You had to share a bathroom with everyone. There was fleas in the bathroom, folks. I had placed myself in that situation by my own hands. I went from having everything that I thought I should have in life. I had a reputation. I hung out with all the rock stars. I did all that. How on earth do I end up in a room? With cockroaches. How did I get here? I took matters into my own hands. I thought I knew the best way to live. And it all came off the rails. It all fell apart. But then one day, I realized that that wasn't what life was all about. And believe me, some of you know this situation. Some of you have lived it. But I called upon the name of the Lord, and he helped me. There was nothing else to do. I was making trips to the soup kitchen. Amen? Have you been there? Do you know what I'm talking about? There was nothing to go back to in Egypt. There was nothing going on. Not even to go back home. My mom was bipolar. I got kicked out of every group home, you name it. Foster home, I got kicked out. I was unwanted, folks. I didn't even want myself. I don't think the cockroaches wanted me. But God did. God did. And that was the difference. And he saved me out of despair and led me into his promises. And folks, I will never turn back from those things. Never turn back. Romans chapter 8, verse 31. What shall we say to these things then? If God is for us, who can be against us? Isaiah 4:32, claim these promises over your own life. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you won't be burned. Think of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And the flame, it will not consume you. Jesus was the fourth man in their fire. Amen. Nebuchadnezzar said, there is one there that looks like the Son of God in that fire. God wants to do battle for you. Point number 6, when we rest secure in God's word and we know it's perfect and we're not into self-preservation. See, self-preservation is a dangerous way to live. I just described that. Preserving yourself. As if you were a jar of jelly or something. Deuteronomy 33:12. Of Benjamin he said, may the beloved of the Lord dwell in safety by him. He shields and covers him all day long. And he dwells between his shoulders. You rest in between God's shoulders when you trust in him. You rest in his strength. The strength of a man is in his shoulders, isn't it? God draws these powerful metaphors for us to look at. And he does it in ways that he can describe it in human characteristics. And guys, we think about that. When you carry your son, you used to carry him on your shoulders. Those of you that have children, you'd carry him on your shoulders and they would rest in your strength. Amen? They would hang onto your head and just rest in your strength. Amen? And that's what God wants to do with us. He wants us to rest in his strength. Amen? The shoulder. This word is used in the Bible both literally and figuratively. In both cases, the shoulder is usually shown as a part of the body that carries the burden. Any of you that have been in the military, you know that you carry the backpack, and where would the weight sit? On your shoulders, in between your shoulders. Amen? The ancients carried heavy objects such as water jars on their shoulder. The shepherd who found his lost sheep, depicted in Luke 15:5, carried it on his shoulders. And that's what God does with the lost. He wants to go get that one sheep and do what? Carry it in his strength back into his promises. There's an echo. A name of God is called Yahweh. In his dealings with his children, the one, the Lord, loves rests between his shoulders. It's time to stop toiling. It's time to stop fixing. It's time to stop solving your problems under your own strength and rest in the power of God. Let's review. When we pray, we can pray directly and personally and give our concerns to God and rest securely in Him. When we dwell in God's Word, it is a light that makes our path clear. God's Word is the light of our life. We could interchange that with God's promises. And we can seek that light long before we venture outside our homes. Study the people that prayed. Study the prophets that prayed. Study those things, and they got up early in the morning and they got with God before they got into their own strength. So many people say, hey, you know what? I'll do my devotion at the end of the day after my strength is used up. Then I'll seek God. But no, seek Him early while He may be found, and that you may rest in His strength, beloved. Seek Him in the morning. Give Him the best of your day. God doesn't get our seconds when He wants to give us His first, the best of Him. Why would we give Him the last, the least, or ask Him to follow us and help us when we're in our deepest trouble? Why would we do that? It makes no sense at all, but yet we tend to do that, don't we? We need to trust in God and find true security within His promised blessing. You can be secure in God. Folks, you can be secure in God that He will do battle for you. When you stand on His Word, when you make it your way of life. See, we can rest in God's Word. It is perfect. And self-preservation is not. It's a dangerous way of living. It's residing outside of His promise. It's saying, God, I don't need to be on your shoulders today. Let's pray. Let's pray to the Lord. Pray with me, will you? Say, Lord, I want to rest between your shoulders. Of your word by faith, so I will make it my way of life when I wake up, throughout my day, before I lay down to go to sleep. I will be secure knowing the battle belongs to the Lord. Praise God. Can we sing together?
When I feel afraid and I think I've lost my